Greetings to everyone who is watching this video. Welcome to RMC TV with another episode on Let's Talk Bible. Today we'll be discussing the topic which we've entitled Worship. And as usual in the studio, I'm joined with Mr. Lusekelo. Welcome, sir. Nice to have you in this program.
Thank you so much, Freddie, for having me. I'm so excited and glad.
Thank you so much. So, the scripture that we're looking at before we go into details with what worship is Exodus 24, verse 5. And the Bible says, "You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below." Then 5, "You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God." So now, Mr. Lusekelo, help us understand the meaning of worship in general and what it means to worship God.
Okay, thank you so much, Fred, for that beautiful question. Before I even attempt maybe to answer your question, I'd like to take us back to the Old Testament, just like you have read in the scripture, but also maybe just to add up and maybe just to spice up something. For a long time, the concept of worship has been misunderstood and misinterpreted by many people because we only see the English definition of what the word says of what worship is. But then my mentor always tells me to say, if you want to understand the Bible, you have to go back to the original version that happens to be the Greek and also the Greek and understand it from that perspective. So when you check the general definition that you will find of worship is bow down.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the common definition of worship, which means in Hebrew to prostrate or to lay down, like someone is lying down, to go down, to bow down. That's the general definition of what worship is. Yeah.
Okay, so now when God was saying do not worship the idols, what did he really mean? Like in simpler terms, what does it mean to worship God?
Okay, so now when we talk of worshiping God, we are talking of many elements. We have first to understand what worship is itself, because you cannot fall into something like, for instance, you cannot worship what you don't know. Right, so there has to be an aspect of you getting you get to a point to say, what am I worshiping or what am I bowing down to? So there has to be that level of understanding. So when you check from the scripture, God is saying to say, do not worship any other idol, because God is the supreme God, but it doesn't mean that he is the only God. You see, what makes something a God is when people idolize something. Do you know that you can make your TV to be your God and you start worshiping your God? So a God is simply something that you pay homage to, or something that you give more priority than other things. Alright, so there are people that, for instance, I'm not going to say, but there are people that we consider to be idol worshippers. The thing is, what do they worship? You get, so when God is coming from that direction, he's saying to say, do not, like, you know, form anything to be your idol. Don't do that, because he is a jealous God, which means worship, it's him who takes it, it's his. You get my point? So that's the many interpretation that we can get from that scripture. God was trying to give us a smile to say that we should not be more like idol worshippers, because like I've said, someone can idolize a TV, someone can idolize a person, they can, you know, human worship. You get my point? So that's what he was just trying to get out from that content.
Okay, so let's take it, for instance, you are evangelizing maybe at the market or at any street, then you meet this person, you are telling them that you're giving them the second commandment that thou shalt not worship any other god but him only. Then now this person comes about, like, tell me the reason why I should worship God. What can you reply?
Okay, so The first reason why we worship God is because it was a command. Uh-huh. Like you have read from the scripture to say, do not worship. It's a command. Uh-huh. So the first reason why we are worshiping God is because that was the command that God gave us, to worship Him. Mm-hmm. If you go back to the book of Genesis, you'd find out that there are two things that God gave to the first man that He created, that happens to be Adam. The first thing was to tear the land, which means to wake to the land. The other thing was fellowship. What is fellowship? Koinonia. What is koinonia? It is a praise or a time of intimacy. That's where worship comes in. So why do we worship God? It's because first, it was a command. Second is because we have come into Him. What do I mean by coming into Him? We have come into an understanding to say He is the only God who is faithful. He is the only God who is righteous. He is the only God. It's not that we don't have any other gods. Uh-huh. We do have other gods. But on all the gods that we have found Him to be trustworthy. So, number one, we worship Him because it is a command. And that is what is important. We worship God because that's a command that He gave us. Number two, we worship Him because we have found Him to be trustworthy, that we can trust Him with our lives. We can trust Him with our substances. Yeah.
John 4:23, the Bible says, yet time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. So, according to what God is saying in John 4:23, we see two major words or two key words, which is spirit and truth when it comes to worship. So the first question that I would ask is that, how does one get to worship the Father in spirit?
Okay, thank you so much. So here is another confusion also. Like, when you're studying the Bible, one of the things that they advise is be cautious of how the words are being used. Uh-huh. So what confuses a lot of people in that scripture is when the Bible talks of spirit. Uh-huh. All right. So many people take it to say it's the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
So it's not the Holy Spirit that he's talking about, because the way that has been used there is it's a small letter S, which means God, Jesus, was talking about worshiping God with your human spirit, right? Because man was made, I would say, is a tripartite. He has the spirit, the body, and the soul, all right? So every true worship comes from the spirit, not from the mind. Mm-hmm. But today we have fashioned worship in such a way that worship is moved. We think worship is a song, right? Mm-hmm. We think worship is a song. We think worship is about instrument. This is why you see in some churches, if there is no sound, people can't worship, because that's what they have been tuned to. That's what they have been wired to. We think worship is sound. We think worship is a song. So if there is no music, then we can't worship. That's not true. If you check from the Bible, worship goes beyond sound. It goes beyond instruments. All right? So that scripture alone tells us to say there is something that God is trying to pass around. Now, the question that I asked myself about that scripture is, that hits my mind, is this. Does it mean in those days there were no people that were worshipping God? Because how can you come to search for something which is already valuable?
Yeah, yeah.
So how are you searching for something? If it is already there, why are you searching for it?
Why are you searching for it, for sure?
So it means that even during those days, there were people that used to consider themselves like today worshippers, that we are worshiping God. But in actual sense, according to the principles and definition of worship, according to the standard of God, they were not worshiping. This is why until date, God is searching for worshippers. Because what we have taken in the church today as worship, if you go down deep the roots of the Bible, you try to say it, you find that it's not worship. So what God is trying to communicate is that true worship starts with your spirit. It doesn't start with your soul. It doesn't start with your mind. True worship starts with your spirit. Your spirit must be the one that starts the worship. Then your mind and your body only expresses what your spirit is feeling inside. So God is saying that He's looking for people that can worship Him in spirit, meaning your human spirit. Then in truth, it has to be in content. You know, the book of Isaiah, it says something, it says, these people, they draw close to me with their mouth, and they also draw close to me with their lips, but yet their hearts are far away. So what God is looking, so in worship, what we take there in worship is our spirit. We communicate, God is spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit. So we connect with him using our spirit. So songs that are based, that are considered to be worship songs, are those songs whereby if my spirit in me is expressing something, right? My spirit, for instance, you're a fire omega. I feel it from the inside. Then my mind conveys it, then expresses it. Then it comes out as a song. Then people mistake that for to be a worship song. In actual sense, when you follow it, there is no worship song. There is only a worshiper that expressed him or herself through a song.
Through a song. Wow.
Yeah, so these days we see that there are two words which are used interchangeably, which is praise and worship in most churches that we go to. So I want you to help us understand, is there a difference between praise and worship?
Okay, amazing. So the difference between praise and worship is very slight. It's not that big. It's just that, you know, so it's just that the setup of the church, the way we have been wired, is what affects us the most. So we were wired in such a way to say, if you hear any fast song, it's a praise song.
It's a praise song.
If you hear any slow music, it's a worship song.
Uh-huh.
But what is praise? What is worship?
What is worship?
Sure. This is what we should understand. I always ask people this question to say, can you tell me the rhythm that David was using when he was singing?
Exactly.
Was it the first one? Was it the slow one? So how do we define if it was a worship or a praise song? So the difference is so slight. Praise is talking about the things that the Lord has done.
Okay.
The creation.
Uh-huh.
The wonderful things. That's praise. Now we are praising him. Thank you for the heavens that you created. That's praise. Thank you for the health. Thank you for my life. But when it comes to worship, the all object changes. The all object of worship is God. Who is God? Who is he? Mighty God. Faithful God. You see the difference?
Yeah.
The other things we are talking about, the creation that he has created, we are praising him for that. But in worship, it is totally about him. But then you cannot worship God minus thanksgiving and praise. Because these two will lead you into a mode of seeing what God is. For instance, I'll give you an example. You can't be saying you're worshiping God. The only thing you're saying that, God, I worship you. God, I worship you. God, I worship you. Like, that's not worship. You're just talking. There must be a component while you are worshiping. For instance, I just come to say, Fred, thank you. Thank you for what?
Yeah, for sure.
You get the point? Uh-huh. So when we talk of praise and worship, the difference is so slight. Okay, it's not about the music. No. It's not about the music. It's about the content. The content is what distinguishes. It's not about the music. I can sing a fast song, but if the content is that of worship, it's considered to be worship. Right? So, worship and praise, the difference is very minimal and very small. Praise talks about the things that God has done, like the creation and other stuff. That's praise, all right? But then worship, it's about him. Who is God, all right? Who is God? But praise, it's about God and the creation. But worship, it's all about who is God.
Okay. I would like to understand, is there a perfect time or place for a particular person to go praise the Lord and worship God? Perfect time and perfect place. Is wow. there such?
Wow, amazing. Now, remember, as Christians, we are led and guided by the Bible. So whatsoever that we give, it has to be in content. Remember the scripture you just read. The Bible says, the time has come. Where people should worship where?
In spirit and in truth.
Mm. So the dispensation it tells you that the dispensation that we are living in, we have been advantaged. We can worship God anywhere. Mm-hmm. Even right now, mm-hmm. we can create that, you know, communicate with the Father. So there is no, you know, specific place that you can go to worship God. Remember, worship starts from
your spirit. Yeah.
So there's no specific place. Why do we go to church and worship God? Maybe that could be the question that maybe the viewers will be asking themselves.
Yeah.
The reason why we go to church to worship God in such a way is because number one, also it is a command. Remember, do not neglect the gathering of togetherness, at least it's a sum of one. Because when we come together, we share graces, all right? We share graces. And then the main things that happens when we come in such a manner to worship. But doesn't mean that the only place that you worship, and this also, just thank God for that question. This takes me back to how this church setup has been put. Because most of the times, people, they only worship God when it comes on Sundays. Because that's how we were wired. That's how we are trained. So we only come, the whole week, Monday, Friday, you are just seated. Like when you come to church now, you raise up your hands, I worship. It doesn't work like that. Mm. Because number one, worship is a lifestyle. It's how you live. I wish we could go back to the Old Testament and just draw out the meaning of worship. So worship is a lifestyle, how you live. Worship is a sacrifice, it's a lifestyle, how you live. That's what worship is. Remember in the Old Testament, when people wanted to give sacrifice, they used to keep a lamb for 7 days. Now, what used to happen during those 7 days is that anytime that lamb that they're keeping has got a default or a problem, they could take out the lamb and replace it with another lamb. They used to give a lamb that is pure and worthy before the king as a sign of what? Worship. So you see why I told you worship goes beyond sound. So it's a lifestyle, how we live. How are we living our life? Remember in the book of Romans 12, 1 verse 2? The Bible says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. If you go in NIV, it uses to say, this is the proper worship. It is the true and proper worship. So your lifestyle is also considered to be worship. Now, just answering your question, where can we worship God from? You can worship God from your house, your vehicle, your bathroom. I sing, I worship God anytime, in any place, because God has given us that advantage through Jesus Christ, through His death. The Bible says the curtains were removed. That barrier of going to the mountains to worship God is no longer there. We now worship Him anyway. Now I'm gonna worship Him anyway.
Thou shalt not worship any other God except Him, the Creator. Today we were just discussing worship, and if you go deep into worship, you discover that this is the second commandment amongst the 10 that were given to the prophet Moses. So, Mr. Lusekelo, in the conclusion on this topic, what can you tell the viewers who are watching us right now?
Okay, thank you so much, Fred. So, in my conclusion, what I'd like to do is just to sum up the whole topic so that maybe if you miss something along the way, you catch it. Like I said earlier on to say, it's about how we were wired and how we were trained on how to define what worship is. So, worship, like I've said, it goes beyond sound, it goes beyond a song, all right? And one thing that we must understand is that worship cannot be done outside the covenant, alright? And worship cannot be done outside the word of God, okay? So, worship is a lifestyle. How you live, that's worship. Romans 12, verse 1 to 2. Presenting your body as a living sacrifice, worthy before the Lord, alright? But if you want to understand the practical, alright, the practical definition of worship, on all the books that have been talked about, that have tried to explain what worship is, the base is Revelation 4, starting from 1 until 11. Worship cannot be done unless you see something in God. I'll give you an example. From Genesis, the Bible says, when Abraham saw the angel that came before him, he saw something that was unique, that was beyond the normal. The Bible says he worshipped. So worship goes beyond just you sing the songs. It's about what do you see in God. Alright? When you go back to the birth of Jesus Christ, when the wise men came up before Jesus, the Bible says, when they saw the child, this hit my mind, when they saw the child, the Bible says, they bowed down to worship. Excuse me, why are you worshiping a baby? You get the whole issue. Why are you worshiping a baby? It's because they saw something beyond a baby. So worship takes you as a person seeing something beyond. If you go back also to the scripture that I've given in the book of Revelations for this raven, the Bible says, when the 24 elders heard the angel singing, then they saw the majesty. They saw the majesty. Then they bowed down and worshiped him. The question is, what kind of seeing did they see? So it goes back there. Worship starts with you. It's a lifestyle. What do you see in God? Who is God to you? That prompts the whole aspect of worship. So you have to see something which is beyond the normal. That's why you find in churches some people are worshiping, some people are looking like... Someone is seeing something, someone is not seeing something. So worship, the best definition that I can give for today is worship is a lifestyle. How you live from Monday to Monday. That's worship. Worship is not what we come to do on Sunday. Worship is what we do from Monday to Monday or Monday to Sunday. That's what worship is. It's a lifestyle, how we live. All right? And how do we worship God? We don't worship God through songs.
Yeah.
That has been the culture of the church. So we worship God through songs. No. It goes beyond sound. We worship God in spirit and in truth. We've already explained that. The other way you worship God is in the fear of God. Not in fear of God, in the fear of God. There has to be that aspect of reverence. Remember what I'm talking about, the common scripture that I'm using? Revelation. When the 24 elders, the other issue is that when people hear the 24 elders, they think those are men with bald heads, beards like this. No. When we hear the 24 elders, the Bible is simply talking about men that have matured in Christ. Now, when you check the posture of the 24 elders, they have thrones and they have crowns. Now, when they saw the majesty, all that became useless. So in worship, there has to be that level of, fear of God. You know, what is the fear of God? The fear of God is simply means the departure or hating evil. Because one thing that God does to a man when he reveals himself to him is that he reveals what holiness is to a man. The other thing is, how do you worship God? In holiness. Remember we talked about the lamb that was kept for 7 days? There has to be that purification in a Christian life. This is why I don't support this issue of calling our team that sing as worship team.
Worshippers.
Because not everyone who sings is a worshipper. There are qualifications that makes one a worshipper. It's not about knowing the crescendos. No. Worship is a lifestyle. How is somebody living? You know, when we talk of worshippers, we're talking about men that are devoted to God. Men that can carry the praises of God. So we have reduced worship to sound, which is so bad. We have reduced worship to a Sunday service. So this is why you hear people when the music on Sunday, I'm not saying musicians, you should not stop rehearsing. Please do your rehearsals. Perfection is good. But we should not reduce it to sound. When people just make a mistake, say, worship. We didn't worship. There was nothing. There was no worship. Why? Because we have reduced worship to sound and a Sunday program. This is why in church today, most special Pentecostal Jews, you have praise, then
worship,
culture. You see? But worship goes beyond that. It's a lifestyle. How are you living? How do you worship him? This one, you like it, you don't like it. If you don't do it, you are not qualified to be a worshiper. Because the posture of the worshiper, according to the Bible, remember, we have not touched so many scriptures. Do you know that worshippers in the Bibles were taught how to worship? People that were called worshippers, they were trained. This is why you have people like David, They were trained on how to worship because, you see, the presence of God has got protocol or principles on how you go to it. Psalms 108, there's 1 to 4. Enter his gates with what? Thanksgiving. That's a protocol. You cannot enter the presence of God without thanksgiving. So people that we are seeing in those days, they were trained even on how to invoke the presence of God. They were trained even on how to play instruments. You know that today what we have in churches, I'm sorry to say this, 99.9% what we have are singers and not worshippers. They qualify for singing but not for worship. We have musicians and not worshippers. This is why most people, if the church that doesn't, if you don't pay them, you won't see them.
Yeah, for sure.
Because they are not devoted to that service. Worship is a service. The same Romans 12 is 1 to 2, when you read it, the Bible says it's a service. Worship is a service that you render to God. You see? So there has to be that component as a body of Christ where we collect ourselves by going back to the foundation and understanding what the Bible says about worship. And how best can we help our choirs? I don't call them worshippers. I only call those that I know to say this one has characteristics, because there are characteristics that qualifies one to be a worshipper. One has to be devoted to God. One has to be devoted to prayer. Anyone who calls himself or herself a worshipper and they do not know the secret place, they are not worshippers. Because all worshippers, do you know why the throne of God is surrounded by? It's not surrounded by, that the way we say that it's surrounded by our, what's this, musicians. No. It's surrounded by worshippers. This is why when you hear the Bible, it doesn't, you rarely hear the Bible say they serve unto the Lord. It is they worship. They worship, because when you check the principle, it's surrounded by the cherubim and the seraphim, then the 24 elders. Now, when you check all this, what do? They don't sing, they worship.
They worship.
Worship is not cheap. It's so expensive. That's why God is still looking for worshippers.
Worshippers.
If it was so cheap, anyone could have been worshipping. But because it's not so cheap, it comes with the price that one has to pay. Remember, it's a lifestyle. How do you live from Monday to Sunday? That's what worship is. So it's not cheap. That's why it's not found. That's why God is still searching for worshippers. Even today, he's still searching. If God had to come today and say, these are the worshippers, you'll be shocked that even some people that you call worshippers, they're not. They're only singers with good voices. They know how to hit keys. So, yeah, so we just need to revisit what worship is. Like, we can't, you know, sum up the whole topic of worship in this session, because they, you know, people need verification of scriptures, where you are coming from, and all sorts of things. But I believe the viewers will get one or two things from here.
Sure. So if you have any question concerning worship, feel free to go into the comment section and drop your questions, then we'll surely get back to you. Let's Talk the Bible. It is a program that you are watching, and featured on this topic, we had Mr. Lusekelo, and it's me, Fred Mlenga. If you are watching us on YouTube and you've been blessed, subscribe, share this video to the beloved one. And if you are watching us on Facebook, do likewise. Stay blessed. We love you.